Good evening to all. I hope you have enjoyed today's morning session related to the college familiarization and academic familiarization. It is a very pleasant evening and we all having a well-known and famous personality in the Indian aviation field. He is none other than respected Mr. Amrish Agrawal, sir. He is an Associate Vice President Engineering at IndiGo Aviation Limited, that is IndiGo. He started at Vayudut Airlines, which was a subsidiary of Indian Airlines. This job took him to the remotest corner of our country. Life was good, but there was no challenge. That is when civil aviation started opening up in India, most of people were apprehensive if the private airlines would be able to survive. At that time, Jet Airways was the most progressive in their vision and had started with B737 and 300. I knew what to do. He left a government job to join a relatively unknown airline called Jet Airways. The management of Jet Airways was able to put together a very creative team and he did very well. He was posted in Delhi. They started with a total of 3 employees and few contract staff with 3 flights a day. By December 2015, there were 450 staff in Delhi with 95 flights a day. Delhi was not only air maintenance, line maintenance, but also had workshop, light base team, power plant group, and a logistic hub. Work had also started towards making base maintenance facility at Delhi Hangar. He later moved to engineering quality at Mumbai. He was working as general manager engineering quality. He was the quality assurance manager, that is QAM, for CAMO 145 and 147 organization of Jet Airways. Effective from 21st August 2017, he joined IndiGo Airlines as Associate Vice President Engineering in maintenance. It is our immense pleasure, sir, to have you in our orientation program, and we are very much thankful to you on your very busy schedule. You have respected our invitation to address our first year student. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Snehaji. Thanks a lot. Hi, guys. I have been given a short brief by Ms. Sneha. I thank her for introducing me to you guys. I hope everybody can hear me. Surbhi, can you confirm?
Yes, we can hear you, Amrishji.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Okay, thanks. So today is your first day in college and you are entering into a new life. All of you must be 18, 19, 20 kind of an age. I remember this day very well in my life. That was in 1984. And it was 1st of November 1984 when my college was supposed to start. Just to give you small history there, I would be speaking on the history itself the whole 1 hour. That day, 1st November 1984, Ashokaji should be knowing, he should be remembering, on 31st October, Indira Gandhi was shot dead. So 1st November, the course did not happen. So when I went to the college, there were tanks rolling on the streets of Delhi. So the course started a month later. So that was the start. And this was in Jamia Millia Islamia, where my engineering, I did my aircraft maintenance engineering, which later on moved to Delhi Flying Club after 2 years. So when I entered aviation, the aviation was basically government-led aviation. The job was there in Indian Airlines and Air India, and there were hardly any opportunities beyond that apart from in defense. I had joined aviation without much knowledge as to what happens there. why did I want to join aviation? Somebody was there very high up. I was looking upon him. Family used to love his job. He used to travel abroad. He used to do big things. Everybody thought that, yes, this is the way to go. And I joined aviation. Heart to heart, I wanted to join Indian Defense, but for some reason, I could not join Indian Defense. Being the only son, my mother did not allow me to join Indian Defense. So that was the reason I did not join Indian Defense. Otherwise, heart to heart, I wanted to join Indian Defense. So aviation and this aircraft maintenance, there is a distinction which a lot of people did not know at that point of time. Now you are in a college. I would take this opportunity to step in into Mr. Ashoka's shoes and tell you that when we talk about aviation, it is a general term. But when we talk about engineering, it again gets divided into aircraft design, aircraft manufacturing, and aircraft maintenance, apart from trainings and others. I would more be speaking on aircraft maintenance. There is a very big aspect of aircraft design and aircraft manufacturing, which is a separate zone altogether, and that is a separate world altogether. But I would be concentrating more on aircraft maintenance, and that is where most of you people will find employment later on. The start of Indian aviation or commercial aviation started with the cargo movement, which all of you must be knowing that J.R.D. Tata was the first person to fly a de Havilland turboprop airplane, not a turboprop, a piston airplane. From Mumbai to Karachi to carry the post. He had that zeal to start an airline in India, and which ultimately got converted into Tata Airlines. And he started building up an airline in India with a lot of domestic sectors. One thing which was quite strange, that at that point of time, and even quite late, the government did not have much of interest in development of airline in India. The airlines were being developed purely because of private participation at that point of time. I'm talking about prior to the independence of India. So we had Tata Airlines at that point of time, and then we had a lot of small airlines which were related to the kingdoms. In India, we had Kalinga Airways, we had Bharat Airways, we had a couple of few. There was a Birlaji Ka airline also. Birlaji was Bharat Airways, then Kalinga Airways was there. Then there were few airlines. Deccan Airways was there. So these were small airlines that were moving around in India, and it was a fairly unorganized way of running an airline. So post-independence, government nationalized. Government nationalized Air India. It became Tata Airlines, but partly owned by the government of India. And government merged all these private airlines into Indian Airlines. So at that point of time, about 1952, 1953, we had then two airlines in India. One was Tata Airlines, which later on became Air India, and one was Indian Airlines, dividing into domestic operation and international operation. This thing worked for quite some time, and at one point of time, Tata Airlines became totally nationalized, and J.R.D. Tata walked out of the airline. He did not remain the chairman of the company. He walked out, became purely a government entity. And India at that point of time, rather Air India, was doing fairly well in the world of Indian aviation and world of aviation. We had, we could be termed as one of the leaders in aviation in the world. Tata had a very good reputation. Air India had a very good reputation. Our engineering services were very good. We had a lot of engineering infrastructure for that point of time because the support was not there and it was decided that let us have our own support. So Air India and Indian Airlines developed magnificent engineering infrastructure. Aircraft were added. We were the first ones to add 707 into the fleet. That was the first jet commercial airplane. It brought in a lot of revenue to Air India. Indian Airlines went in to bring a wide body into domestic. That was an Airbus 300. They added an Airbus 300 to their fleet. It was one of the big revenue generators for Air India. Air India did for Indian Airlines. Indian Airlines did very well. And then, as luck would have it, this aviation I have seen is like a wheel. It keeps on turning. You have ups and downs, ups and downs. And then there was this big order of A320, which Indian Airlines had placed. It was one of the biggest orders of A320s in the world, and Indian Airlines was one of the launch customers for 320s. I'm talking about 1985-86. The aircraft had started coming in. It was a totally different airplane. It was a out-of-the-world airplane. It was far modern, far modern than what Indian Airlines had expected it to be. And Indian Airlines was not prepared to absorb that kind of technological jump. Unfortunate events happened. So there were two events which were very, very unfortunate that happened at that point of time. One was that one 320 crashed in Bangalore. It was catastrophic. A lot of people died in it. And another was a political disaster of Rajiv Gandhi losing the election. What happened was a political game which changed the Indian aviation forever. The new government which came in was looking for briberies and this kind of stuff. They grounded the 320 fleet of Indian Airlines. The entire fleet of about 50-60 airplanes was grounded. With that kind of grounding happening, Indian Airlines got into a tailspin. There was money going out for the aircraft payments. There was no money coming in. Aircrafts were being maintained. Aircrafts had to be maintained. 2 years, the airplanes got grounded. Later on, when the new government came in, they released it. Indian Airlines started limping back to normalcy. Limping back to normalcy. At that point of time, the world had moved. The economy had started opening. There was a huge demand for aviation. And Indian Airlines was not capable to cater for that demand. It was not equipped to cater for that demand. In order to fulfill that demand, the government started looking at private players again. The wheels had started again moving. So they brought in a concept of air taxi services. This was the time when I was passing out from the college. This was the time when I joined Vayudut, which was one of the third airlines in India, a subsidiary of Indian Airlines. So government started experimenting as to how we can bring in private players to start flying. So they started something known as air taxi operation. Jet Airways also started as an air taxi. It was not an airline. East-West was not an airline when it started. They were air taxi. So there were limitations. There were restrictions. The restrictions were that we cannot publish our schedule. We cannot go to any destination where Indian Airlines is already flying within half an hour of landing. So if Indian Airlines is flying Delhi-Bombay and it is landing in Bombay at 9 o'clock, Jet Airways cannot land from 8:30 to 9:30 in Bombay, Delhi-Bombay. Those were the kind of limitations. These numbers, flight numbers were not there. Flight numbers were ad hoc. So with all that limitations, even then, the private enthusiasm were there. There were people who had vision in Indian economy, in Indian system. They came in forward and started airlines. Government saw this as an improvement and then decided that why don't we convert them into a proper airline. So 1st October 1994 was when government decided to convert few air taxi operations into airlines. And that was the day Jet Airways became an airline. That was my first day of employment in Jet Airways, because earlier to that, I was working for Jet Airways in a MRO form. I was not working in Jet Airways. I mean to say, I was in an engineering company that was supporting Jet Airways. But from 1st October 94, when Jet Airways became an airline, it was decided that airline should have its own engineering, own maintenance. So that was the time that engineering division, which was supporting Jet Airways, became part of Jet Airways. That was my first day of employment in Jet Airways, though I was there much earlier with Jet Airways. Private airlines at that point of time were East West, Modi Luft, NEPC, Damania, UP Airways, mushrooming. Lot of opportunity, lot of airlines. People were getting jobs very, very easily. That was one of the peak times. 4 years down the time, the wheel again started turning. Airlines started collapsing. The people who had started these airlines did not understand the basic mathematics. Few survived, few did not survive. Jet Airways was the one which survived. Again, geopolitical exposures have a tremendous effect on an airline industry. Towards 2010-2011, we had 9/11 in USA. That 9/11 was again a very big game changer. With 9/11 happening, airlines started again shutting down. Few survived. There was, after 9/11, the change which had started coming in Indian aviation was growth of low-cost carriers. We had Deccan Aviation, Air Deccan, we had Indigo for that matter came in, and few more low-cost airlines came in. And the concept of low-cost airlines was basically that we will not give you food on board, we will not give you this on board, we will go from a low cost terminal, there were no frills attached to it, we will try to bring in the cost of the ticket so that make people affordable to fly. Economy was opening, the aspirations of people were changing, there were people, more and more people wanted to fly, and these airlines were targeting those as customers. At that point of time, legacy carriers were Indian Airlines, legacy carriers were Jet Airways, legacy carriers were Kingfisher. They did not see this new change happening. The new change was that people want to fly cheap, people want to fly at low cost. Airlines have to reduce our cost to compete with the new players. The new players were learning from the mistakes from the old players, and they were not doing things the way old players were doing things. They were doing things differently. The wheels started turning again, and we had these mega airlines, Indian Airlines, which became merged into Air India at one point of time. They became one. Jet Airways, Kingfisher, falling from the skies. And other airlines like SpiceJet, like Indigo started growing up, going big. And overall, aviation grew. Overall, there was a growth in aviation. India became number 3 slot in the world in the growing aviation market after US and China. From students like you, huge amount of opportunity had opened up. Now we had this COVID-like situation. This COVID-like situation was something which nobody had seen. Nobody had ever thought of that this kind of event can happen, which can have such far-reaching effects in everybody's world, everybody's life, including aviation. Aviation was one of the first industries to get hit by COVID. All the airlines stopped flying effective 23rd of March in India. There was complete grounding of fleet. By May end, there was a little bit effort made to open up Indian skies. It is moving now. About 50% of the fleet of Indian market is now flying. And by end of this year, this financial year, means to say March 21, there might be a good chance that we reach the pre-COVID level. There is a good chance that with that, if we reach that kind of levels, we will see that aviation will become a better place, and there would be good job opportunities for everybody. So this was a brief outlook of how the Indian aviation has spanned over this 50, 40, 50, 60 years. I would go into small nitty-gritties. The aircraft maintenance as a profession is very unique. There is not very many professions which are like aircraft maintenance. It is unique in a way that the learning never stops. There is a continuous wave of learning that happens. One of the big reasons of this learning is that there is a continuous development in aviation in terms of the aircraft. The aircraft continuously, the same aircraft, the 320 which Indian Airlines had ordered in 1983 and 320 which is there, is a far different 320. So there is a continuous upgrade in the product, even though the product is technically the same. There is a continuous upgrade. So that continuous upgrade will keep on, as an aircraft maintenance engineer, will keep on forcing you to learn more, to basically research more, learn more. That is one. Second thing which is very, very unique about aircraft maintenance as an industry is that it is very, very regulated, extremely controlled. We have DGCA, which is a government body which regulates. we have the manufacturer which regulates, we have the airline organizations, the quality organizations within the organization, within the airline, they regulate. With all these regulations in place, engineer technically is in a very, very secured situation. You as an engineer don't have to open up your horizons to do something which is not there. Any situation which comes in, there is a book, there is a procedure, there is a write-up which you need to refer to, and with that write-up, you need to take an action. If the write-up is not there, you have to, by mandated law, you have to go to somebody to get your write-up. Either it is your department's quality company or the manufacturer or the regulator, you would have to go to him to give you guidance. With that guidance, you have to go further. So there is not much which you can do and experiment. However, there is a lot of hard work. There is so much of hard work that there is always a catching up. Hard work in means it is a 24/7 job. There are weather limitations. There is nothing sitting inside. It is outside field job for maximum time. There is a small window when the aircraft comes and the aircraft goes. It needs to be serviced at that point of time. I will be speaking on this more. Your reaction time to a situation depends upon your confidence level to check, inspect, and clear. It requires confidence to retrieve information from a backup place if you need to, and come to the aircraft and then deliver. And then post aircraft, there are a lot of work which you have to do. So very, very unique profession. Once you get into the nitty-gritties and you start liking it, you would not like to follow any other profession. I have been in this profession for now 36 years. In this October, I finished 36 years in this profession. And I do not know if I can do anything else. First of all, I don't know anything to do, and I would not like to do that much. I love this profession about. I think I have given you a good amount of feedback on the history of Indian aviation. I would request Surbhi if she can allow the students to do some talking now and ask me something if they want to.
Sure, sir. I would, students, freshers, you have any questions, please raise your hand. Any queries you want to ask, sir, this is a very good opportunity that sir is today with us, among us, sharing all his experiences, the history of aviation. So you can raise your hand and you can ask sir any questions you want. And please be open, because this opportunity you will not get again and again. Sir is a very busy, busy personality. You know, 36 years of experience. Anybody wants to ask any questions? Please raise your hands. Sukumar sir, are you there?
Yes, ma'am, I'm here. Yes, ma'am. So, yeah, now the student Akash raised the hand. So, I will make him.
Yes,
Akash, you can unmute.
Akash, please unmute your microphone, and you can ask the question. Akash, can you hear us?
Akash, please.
Let me clear, Akash.
Sir, I want to know this, that how this aircraft maintenance was started in the first.
How do you?
Subhi, the voice was not very clear. Can you repeat?
Akash, bring your mic close to your mouth and then speak.
You.
How was we started in the first, sir?
How we started the first?
Maintenance program.
How we started the first maintenance program? Is this the question you are asking?
Yes, yes.
So Akash, I will try to answer you. You go historically also. When you buy an aircraft, when you buy a motorcycle, you get a maintenance manual with that. When you buy a car, you get a small manual how to maintain that car or that motorcycle for the minimum standards. That is the first document you get it, and then gradually you develop it and take it. The same thing I feel must have happened when aircrafts were being rolled out. I'm talking about early 1920s, maybe. Aviation was greatly affected and developed by the wars. So the First World War was when aviation, the aircraft aerodynamics took shape. Second World War helped a lot in developing the engine capacities and developing new type of engines which could make the airplanes travel faster. The jet engines started formulating towards the end of Second World War. And then further, the Cold War between America and the East helped develop aviation in terms of the reach of the aircraft. So this was the development of aircraft, and that kept on changing into the civil aviation also. The developments were happening in the defense, and they were going into percolating into civil aviation for purpose of commercial reasons. At that point of time, the maintenance programs started developing. At that point of time, there were not many regulations to be looked into. In India also, there was something known as a Civil Aviation Department, CAD, which was later on divided into the airports part of it and the regulator part of it. So we had DGCA, which came into picture, and we had airports which were there, but a body to govern that airports. So we had International Airport Authority of India, National Airport Authority of India. Ultimately, they merged into the Airport Authority of India, and the CAD then became the DGCA. So this is a development program which has lasted over 40, 50, 60 years. Internationally, the regulators, there was, wherever the aircraft manufacturing was happening, we had regulators to set standards. So we had FAA in USA, Federal Aviation Authority. Then we had a British authority, CAA, Civil Aviation Authority, which was there in England, there was a similar authority in Canada, and then a similar authority in France. The French authority and the British authority merged together and became EASA. So these regulators, because they were part of areas where aircraft manufacturing was happening, they started making maintenance programs. I can go further into that, how a maintenance program is developed for an aircraft, but I don't think that you would be able to grasp right now. Maybe 2 years down the course, probably Ashoka ji would give you another burst on this, as how maintenance programs are developed. But this is how maintenance has gone forward. I hope I was able to tell you something about it.
Akash, yes. Are you clear about it? Did you get your answer?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, he's having some network issues now, so his voice is clear. So he got, I think, everything sir has covered. There was one more student, yes. Shiva Shri Krishna. Mr. Shiva Shri Krishna, you can unmute yourself. You can come forward and you can ask your queries to our officer. Shiva Shri Krishna.
Yeah. Please little louder, Shiva Shri.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Yeah, good evening.
Hi.
So what do you think will be the impact of artificial intelligence over the years in the maintaining of an aircraft?
Your voice is not audible.
Well, he was not very clear, but I think he's saying that what is the effect of artificial intelligence in aircraft maintenance. Am I correct?
Sir, yes, sir. Yes, okay. Sir. What will be the impact of artificial intelligence?
Yeah. So, Shiva, what is there is that artificial intelligence, again, is a word which is in fashion right now quite a lot. But again, it has developed over past couple of years, and it has also entered into aviation the way it is entering into everybody's life today. Today we have mobile phones, Alexa. This is all artificial intelligence getting developed gradually. In aviation also, the effect of computerization, the complications of programs, everything started taking place. So first big change which aviation embraced in terms of aircraft maintenance was a consolidation of data, consolidation of aircraft data, whether it is your maintenance data, whether it is your maintenance program, whether it is your inventory, how much inventory you are holding, what is the life of the inventory, whether you are ordering those parts, can it come on one platform, one computer platform? If we put everything on one platform, so that the time an engineer opens up his, comes to the office, opens up his laptop or computer, he logs in, he knows he has to go on an aircraft. This is the job he has to do on the aircraft. On the computer, he does his sign in. He knows which part he has to go and pick up from the store. When he goes to the store, store knows that the engineer is coming to pick up that part. Store gives him that part, store gives him that tool, because the engineer through his program knows everything about it. Engineer goes to the aircraft, he needs a manual, it is there in the same system. He clicks one hyperlink, he gets the data as to what work, how that work needs to be done. He completes that work, he closes this, goes to the store and finishes it. This is one big platform which is possible and which is being run very successfully by most of the airlines. Second thing which is now coming in into is that you have tools which are interactive. Physical tool is an interactive tool. So you have now boroscope equipments. Boroscope equipments, if I tell you what would be a boroscope equipment, it is like a small micro camera which you put inside an engine, for example. We open up the ports and put a camera which goes deep inside the engine and then sees what is the damage, and that records the damage, and that damage is mapped against the intelligence built in into the computer which is that camera is connected to. It maps that damage against the allowable limits and talks to the manufacturer who is sitting 20,000 kilometers away somewhere in Canada, telling the engineer what all further camera needs to be, and the camera needs can be moved, can be articulated. The camera even has a small grinder, a small vacuum generator with it. And with the camera and that kind of a small grinder, it goes and it clears the damage inside the aircraft engine, like a doctor clearing your arteries and veins, that kind of a thing. And the person sitting in Canada guides him. He then, with the vacuum port connected, collects the debris and brings the camera out. That is the kind of artificial intelligence that is coming in into the aircraft. The computers which are there on board are talking when the aircraft is flying, are relaying the aircraft health, which is there, to the down center, the command center. The aircraft, when it lands at destination, the command center will tell that country of place that the aircraft is coming. This is the snag on the airplane. Be ready with this kind of an equipment. You do not have the equipment that other airlines is having the equipment. I have already connected with that airline. That airline is ready to give you, purchase order has been issued. You just go and collect it. So the aircraft comes in, the computer is there, manpower is there, tuck, it goes. So this is the how artificial intelligence is entering in, and it would be entering in into big way. Drones are entering into the maintenance. Drones are entering into now to look at the aircraft size of a jumbo, size of a 380. You have a damage on top, right on the top of the airplane. How do you go there? Either you get a ladder to go there. It will take 2 hours for the ladder to come. Might as well fly a drone. That drone will go take a photograph. Drone will be connected to the computer. Computer will map it, whether it is an acceptable damage or it is a non-acceptable damage, gone, finish. All that is artificial intelligence, which is taking part, and it is very, very exciting.
Shiva, you are clear?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else, sir?
Thank you, Shiva. Yeah, ma'am, the two students are there. Just I'm taking in.
Right, sir.
Andilip. Yeah,
please, ask your question, Andilip. Can you hear our voice?
First, unmute yourself. Both cameras.
Yes, sir.
Please unmute.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, hi.
Good afternoon.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Please ask your question.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. My question is, sir, I want to know. I want to know. Yes. Hello.
Yeah. Please.
Yes, sir. I want to know you, sir. I choose integrated course, both AME plus aeronautical. That's what type of work in this job, sir? Can you, sir, ask me? Which type of work in this job, both AME and aeronautical? Can you help me, sir, now? Yes, sir. Reason.
Yeah, I understand.
Yes,
so,
sir.
When you take this kind of an integrated course, I would not know much into the detail of your course. Your school would be able to tell you more. But in airlines, there is an engineering department and there is a maintenance department. Maintenance department is aircraft maintenance, and engineering is into the support group, which supports the aircraft maintenance. In engineering, the guys who are there in the engineering department, they are the ones who are talking to the manufacturer, who are developing the maintenance program, who are developing, who are talking to the regulators, DGCA, who are the ones who would be procuring spares for the maintenance. So the support function comes from the engineering. They are the ones who would be talking to the vendors, negotiating contracts, agreements. All this part is engineering. So I think you can, if you do the course, you may be very well adapted for both engineering as well as maintenance.
Yes.
Is this clear now?
Yes.
So it is an added advantage in both the places, whether you are in maintenance, whether you are in engineering.
Engineering. So,
yes. Any of the things you do, yes, you will be, it's always VTEC is an added advantage if you go to maintenance, and if you are in VTEC, maintenance is again an added advantage. So don't be scared. Just concentrate and concentrate on your basics, which will help you in further.
Thanks.
Best of luck for your future. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. The next question, sir.
I'm taking one more student. He's also Aman.
Aman?
Yeah, Mr. Aman, you can.
Aman, can you hear us, please? Aman? Would you like to ask your question?
Bring Aman here, na, then only he will be able to ask. Unmute him.
Yes, sir. Taking him. Yeah, Aman, now.
Aman, please unmute your microphone.
Is not yet connected.
Take Riya Manglani.
Riya, you are in, now you are in panelist, so you can unmute your camera and you can, Riya. Riya?
Riya? Miss Riya, can you hear
Hello?
Us?
Yeah, hi.
Yes, Riya.
Hello, sir. Unmute good evening.
Your, please ask your question.
Yeah, unmute your camera.
Good evening.
Unmute.
Good evening, India.
Sir, please tell us your views on the future of Indian aviation.
Okay, so Riya, this is something very important for you to know. You are entering now. I see a lot of good in happening in next few years in Indian aviation. Indian aviation before the COVID was the fastest growing aviation market in India, in the world. As I had said that we were number three beyond America and China. Post-COVID, the way things are looking, and I will tell you directly from the heart of Indian aviation market, I was on a panel like this yesterday, very, very esteemed people. And one of the comments which came in was that Europe is totally down because of COVID. With the winters coming in, they are only 20%. And with the winters coming in, there would not be any tourists which would be going to Europe anymore. And the airlines in Europe are doing very, very badly. But in India, we are increasing every day. We are increasing, we are opening up every day. We would be touching about 70% of our capacity by Diwali and 100% by March. This is going to give us a huge quantum jump in Indian aviation. Aviation, you should understand, is one of the pillars of growth of a country. Today in India, railways will not be able to take the India to next level in terms of transportation. Railways is choked. There are no more rail routes available. You cannot have double-decker trains everywhere running. It is aviation as a transport pillar which will propel the country to the next level. Railways would be able to support. But to take it to the next level, you require much more. So aviation would be able to do that. In India, we are hardly connected. Still, there is so many cities which are not cross-connected. Raipur is not connected to Chennai. Chennai is not connected to Guwahati. Guwahati is not connected to Patiala. Patiala is not connected to Calcutta. We are so much of potential. These are all big cities. Everybody wants to go. Everybody wants to travel. Everybody wants to do business. So, I am very hopeful that this country, aviation is going to do extremely well. I hope, Ria, you are able to take in this as an answer.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thank you, Ria.
Thank you, Ria.
Sukumar, sir, anybody else?
Yeah, we have Manam.
Yeah, ma'am, another one.
We'll take two more questions from Manam. One from Manam and one from Aman.
Manam,
can we have your question, please?
Yeah, Manam, you can unmute yourself. You can.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah, hi, Aman.
So my question for you is, how has your lifestyle changed after as soon as you came in your aviation industry? In the positives and negatives of...
Avan, this is a very, very nice question. How my lifestyle has changed?
Very personal question.
Aman, I came from a very, very... Which city are you from?
So I'm from Noida, UP. I'm currently staying in Noida and my name is Manan, M-A-N-A-N, Manan.
Manan, okay, fine. Manan. So Manan, you are still better off that you are from Noida. I was from Saharanpur. Saharanpur is a very, very small town in UP. And I came in from that small town to Delhi. Udhar mein bus bhi nahi chalti thi, riksha chalti thi. So that was the first changeover. I had to take a bus from Narayana to Jamia Millia. That was the first lifestyle change I had to do. Main school jata tha, pedal jata tha, ya cycle pe jata tha. Now, the lifestyle change was that I had started taking bus every day. That was a big lifestyle change. So, having said so, that lifestyle change would have occurred with so many people. In aviation, lifestyle change, if you say, post your college, your life changes, you get into shift duties. Airlines 24/7. It is not a profession which ends at 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock in the evening. It works 24/7. So there is one big lifestyle change comes in that you have to do night shifts. And those night shifts, these are quite unforgiving night shifts. You have to work like 8 hours, 10 hours continuously in between, maybe getting half an hour of break. You may not be getting half an hour of break. You do two nights continuously. You go home, sleep. Next day again. More you work, Manan, more you learn, more you grow. These night shifts for any aviator are the biggest universities. Aapka college jo sikhata hai, wo ye night shifts jo hain, do night shifts mein sara college cover kar deti hai. So, that is the first lifestyle change which happens. What other lifestyle change?
So we should start giving them some night shifts also.
Yes, exactly.
So that they will have a practice to be awake.
Manan, you have to get up at 3 o'clock in the night to go to the hangar and prepare the aircraft to fly at 6 o'clock.
It will be an experience. It will be an opportunity.
And if you beforehand. Heard Agarwal sir very clearly, sir said, all these years, sir has only learned to do this, nothing else. He loves his job, he's passionate about his job, and he knows only aviation and aviation. Airport, aircraft, maintenance, engineering, everything. So this is a change.
Yes,
you
and
should
we can
be
see
passionate
that.
About your job. You should be passionate about your work style, lifestyle, discipline. Discipline is very important.
I think he wanted to ask a lifestyle financially change in lifestyle financially.
Financially, yes. Financially, you will grow. Don't worry on that. See, just freshers, you are just starting up.
Manan's father
learn.
Is a pilot, sir. Amrish,
oh.
Sir?
Manan, just as a message, and my son does not like when I speak about this. Meri pehli naukri mein, my first job was 1800 rupees, and every 89th day, my job used to be terminated, and I used to be re-employed on the 91st day, because tab Hindustan ka rule hota tha कि आपने 90 दिन काम कर लिया तो आपको रेगुलर एम्प्लॉयमेंट में आ जाते थे. एन एयरलाइन नेवर वांटेड टू रेगुलरली एम्प्लॉय मी, सो दे वर टेंपरेरी एम्प्लॉयमेंट्स. सो आई वाज अ टेंपरेरी टेक्नीशियन, टेंपरेरी ट्रेनी टेक्नीशियन, टीटीटी. सो दैट इज हाउ आई स्टार्टेड. एंड इन कलकत्ता व्हेन आई यूज्ड टू स्टे देयर एट दिस 1800 रुपीस एज अ सैलरी, देयर वाज दिस जर्मन आंटी जिनके घर में पीजी अकोमोडेशन होती थी. शी वॉज अ जर्मन लेडी, अ जर्मन ज्यू हु वाज मैरिड टू अ बंगाली नियर द एयरपोर्ट. उनकी एक कोठी होती थी, उसमें आई यूज्ड टू स्टे देयर. वो एक जिसको बेड नहीं बोलेंगे, उसको हम तखत बोलेंगे इन नॉर्थ इंडियन लैंग्वेज. आई होप यू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज अ तखत. तो वो तखत मिलता था हमको 5 रुपए डेली के किराए के ऊपर में. तो वो 5 रुपए की डेली के किराए के ऊपर में वो हमको तखत देती थी. एंड आंटी काइंड ऑफ लव्ड मी, सो शी थ्रू इन अ मॉस्किटो नेट फ्री कि अमरीश यू आर अ गुड गाय, सो आई विल गिव यू अ मॉस्किटो नेट फ्री इन दिस 5 रुपीज. सो दैट इज हाउ आई स्टार्टेड. एंड टुडे आई एम क्वाइट वेल ऑफ. सो देयर इज गुड अमाउंट ऑफ.
We can see as hard work pays off. Now we are listening to you once you were as us among us.
Exactly, Manan.
Every exam you take in your life, take it as no opportunity is going to come after that. First message. मैं कितने लोगों से मिलता हूँ exam लेते हैं कि सर ये तो हम पहला attempt ले रहे हैं, अभी तो सेकंड अटेम्प्ट भी लेंगे, थर्ड अटेम्प्ट भी लेंगे, पहला अटेम्प्ट तो ट्राई करने के लिए ले रहे हैं. ये सबसे बड़ी गलती होगी और हमेशा याद रखना, ये गलती मैंने कभी नहीं करी. मैंने हर को फर्स्ट अटेम्प्ट को ही ओनली अटेम्प्ट माना, और जिन्होंने सेकंड अटेम्प्ट और थर्ड अटेम्प्ट वाले चले थे आज वो मुझसे बहुत पीछे हैं. हर जगह अपॉर्चुनिटी मिली, हर जगह जिसको बोलते हैं कि यू हैव टू बी एट द करेक्ट स्टैंड, द बस विल कम, बट बी first to go inside that bus.
Yes.
Don't wait ki ji theek hai aur log bhi hain. Be always try to be first on the bus. You will go forward.
Exactly. Manan?
Thank you sir so much.
Motivated? Now you understood?
Yes,
you have to work hard like sir.
For sure ma'am, for sure.
Okay beta,
thank you so much. Thank you ma'am.
Aman is there, we'll take Aman's question.
Yes. Aman, can we take your question, please?
Yes, ma'am. Aman, I have taken already. Aman,
please unmute your microphone.
Hello.
Yeah, Aman, you can switch on your video also.
Good evening.
Sir, my question is that which license in ME is more employable or have a good scope in India, sir? B1 or B2?
So, first thing is that both these license have your own liking as well. What you like more, whether you like B1 more or you like B2 more. And what is happening now is that with the current way of functioning, there is a merger that is happening. So you have B1s who are overreaching into B2, and B2 are getting opportunities to overreach into B1. So saying that B1 is better or B2 is better, first thing is that what is your own area of liking? With your own area of liking, you would make your area of expertise. And then it will go. In terms of employability, definitely B1s are more employable than B2, because B2, on other hand, are less in number as well. So if I see the world way is happening, B1s with overreaching into B2 would be the people who would be more employable.
Yes, sir.
What's your answer, Aman?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Aman.
Thank you, sir. So, Kumar, sir, anybody else?
No, ma'am. Actually, every student has... those who have raised the hand, those who had the queries, it was cleared. Sir has cleared all the queries, those who raised the hand.
Okay. Amri, sir, can we carry forward this?
Yeah.
And take it to the next level?
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir.
Sneha, ma'am.
Amri, sir, we would also like to know about our passed out students who are already working under your supervision. How they are doing, and I think these freshers will be very much motivated with that our passed out students are already working in Indigo. So could you please enlighten us on that?
Yeah. So it was very, very interesting to know. I was talking to Ashoka ji and Surbhi ma'am that who all are the students from your school who are employed in Indigo, and they gave me few names, and then I did my own small research in last half an hour, and it was extremely revealing for me to know that at least 4 people whom I interact extremely every day are from your school. So sir, I have Manoranjan, I have, yes, Parvez, I have Anshul, I have Saurabh. These people are the ones who would meet me like every 10 minutes, every 15 minutes. I did not know that they are from your school. So they are from your school, and I'm extremely proud to have them in my team. And I cannot function without them. Today, if I see myself, whatever I'm doing every day is because of these 4 or 5 people who are around me. So this is what I can say.
Oh, thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. In fact, Parvez and Anshul, both of them, they are classmates.
Yes.
Yeah. Even Manoranjan is your classmate.
Yeah, Manoranjan is junior to Anshul.
Yeah. तो मनोरंजन को तो हर 10 मिनट में मुझसे डांट पड़ती है, तो अंशुल को नहीं पड़ती है, मनोरंजन को तो हर 10 मिनट में डांट पड़ती है. So that is the way it happens. But I work very closely with these guys.
Okay.
Sir, thank you so much for enlightening us on the history of aviation, Indian history of aviation. It was very, very knowledgeable. Many, many things which we forgot. You again recap them. We could hear you. I think students, you people are also quite, you got your answers. This was just a first session with Amri sir. I hope in future we will get Amri sir again with us, as he has always honored us with his presence in our HR meets, seminars, webinars, and he has always enlightened us. He has always showed the best path to our students to walk on. I believe in future, sir, we will again have your presence, and we are very much honored. Very much. Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot.
Now I would ask Ashoka sir for some thank you.
Thank you, Amrishi, for sparing your precious time for us, for our students, and with such a motivational lecture to them. And I hope they must have got motivated and they must have heard a lot of things, what is happening in aviation industry. And in fact, every one of us were worried about the present aviation situation. It is not the present aviation situation, it is the present rickshawala situation also. Even if we see the employment of the rickshawala, even he is also not come back to the pre-COVID situation. So every one of us are expecting for the things to grow, and definitely, like yesterday there was a news in the newspaper regarding opening of new terminal, and it was also a very encouraging news for each one of us, and it was really good to hear from us, from you, 70% of the aviation is already back, and we'll be 100% by March 21. And the students, like you have to, or we will be looking the jobs for you after 4 years, not after March. So prepare yourself, work hard for the field, and prepare yourself technically and knowledge wise both, that is theoretically and practically both, so that you've got a lot of scopes. And we hope ki Amrish ji will be sparing much more time, and we'll feel happy if he visit our institute college sometimes at Nimrana.
Yeah.
And yes, sir, be with us. We are expecting him to our campus now.
Definitely. Thank you so much, Amrish ji. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.
And thanks. Each one of my staff members, those who have supported to make this webinar happen. Thank you, Subhi ma'am, and thank you, all of you. Thank you so much, and best of luck to all the students. Bye. Take care.
Bye-bye, students. Take care. God bless you. Thank you, sir. Bye-bye, sir. Bye-bye, Agarwal, sir. Sir, good evening.
Bye, ma'am. Good evening.
Bye-bye, sir.